Well, that's loud. I'll use it sparingly. Okay, so without further ado, Chris Bardick. Watch out!
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for being here, for inviting me to Canada for the second time. I'm glad to be here. Luckily, the sun came out. For you, you guys think, oh my god, so warm, so hot. It's outside, but I want to go outside. It's now we have snow in Holland. Do you know where Amsterdam is?
Yes.
Yeah. You can't hear me?
I'm getting muffled.
Can you make his mic with a little less space, a little more treble? Both of them?
Yeah. What? Is it better?
Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks,
Lynn. Thank you. Must be my pronunciation as well. My funny accent.
Now you're clear.
Okay, thank you.
All right, and why don't you put up that collage picture as the person on both sides? Oh, there we are.
Oh, who's that?
Who's that gentleman? That's him. Well, I thought we would do something fun and something interactive with the audience.
Yes,
and something as a surprise.
Uh-oh.
How about the Wheel of Marnix?
What sort of surprise is it? What is it? Tell me. So,
don't say that loud, but
I recognize myself in that.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Anything? Everything cool?
Making me? No. Oh.
Well, that's all.
Nice.
This is the closest mic I've ever got to sit next to him. This is special.
So how does it work? Now comes up and turn the wheel?
Yeah, we're going to have somebody come up and we'll let you pick. They'll raise your hand. You'll pick a volunteer. They'll come up, spin it, and you'll start talking about that part of your career, and we'll talk about it a little bit.
Well, that's my whole career. Oh, nice. Well, where's your future? Where's my future career? The middle or circle?
Oh, well, right here, that's when you're there.
That's my future.
That's when you're the new doctor.
Oh, I mean. Funny, Dutch doctor.
Dutch doctor. Dr. Dutch.
Everything is possible.
Well, here, did you know that when you go on a date and both people pay their own? We call that going Dutch.
Oh, really? Why?
I have no idea why, but when you go on a date and if you both pay your own check, isn't it going Dutch?
Yes.
Why is that?
It doesn't sound like a good date, though.
It usually is.
So it's like, how do we know? You sit there, you wait, and then, I mean, I'm a man, so I'm supposed to pay or not. How would you do as a woman? You sit there and you will wait.
If the young lady says, why don't we do this and we do it Dutch? Beginning of the date, you're going home alone.
Yeah.
Okay, so we need a volunteer. Who would like to volunteer for the Wheel of Marnix?
Okay, so start here. In the front. Yeah. We go around, so. Applause!
You get
to win something.
You get to win. Marnix.
Okay, so, and then what color do you think?
Blue.
Stuntman.
Oh, and what's your name?
Barbara.
Excellent. Thank you.
So, you're a stuntman. Are you a stuntman?
Well, not really, but according to IMDb, I am. because for some reason the werewolf, they specified it as a stunt performer.
Really?
Yeah, in the beginning when I auditioned for, when I did the casting for Harry Potter, they wanted me to book me as a special extra, and of course I thought, well, okay, I can understand why you're thinking that, but I consider myself an actor. So I got specified as an actor, but on IMDb I'm still something.
Well, excellent.
I can do stunts, but I don't think you want to pay for that to see that.
I do my own mapping. So how about, who else wants to spin the wheel of Marmot?
Yeah, go on. You sure?
Yeah. Oh, he's a big fan of yours.
I know. He cannot pronounce my name very well, apparently.
But he's like a fanboy.
He saw me a fanboy, too.
Yeah.
No, too.
Oh, three times. Oh.
He's got one.
Mark Shepard's fan is an action. I saw Mark Shepard.
Really?
Mark loves it. He says when you watch the Silence episode, listen to Silence, he has a Dutch accent.
Anytime it's silence in a room, I think of Mark.
I'm not here, you forgot.
Okay,
go on.
What'd you come up with?
Calvin Klein. Number E, Calvin Klein.
I didn't
write it. Yeah, no, so Calvin Klein is a, he's like a, what is he? Yeah, he's a designer.
Good job, Deb.
I didn't write that one.
Sure.
That was
so, it's supposed to be without the E again, Calvin Klein. That's, it's a fashion brand, Klein. Yeah, what do I do for them? I'm on the side as an actor, you know how it goes. You go to a job now and then, and send your board to at home, you don't have a job, and you need the money. So I decided to do a lot of other things on the side. One of them is being an art director for Tommy Hilfiger and Calvin Klein. And what
an art director?
Yeah, it sounds big, but it's just someone who throws parties.
You throw parties?
Yeah. So the fashion brand has a lot of employees all over the world, and the headquarters, one of the headquarters from Calvin Klein and Tommy Hilfiger called PJs, because they're part of the company called PJs, and the headquarters is in Amsterdam. So that's where I live. And so, yeah, I'm responsible for all the bigger events they're throwing, like line openings for every half season. They have new line openings for the new fashion, and they throw parties, and people from all over Europe and all over the world come to Amsterdam to see the new line, the new fashion. And they do a very big event in December, the Christmas party. 1,500 people are sit down dinner and party. So my work involves being creative and say, well, like, I want that, or I want that, and I want people to wear that, and I want models here, and that's what I do.
That's pretty cool, actually, as it is.
Yeah.
That's more than a hobby, that.
And by the way, Calvin Klein, and so PVH just called me in last week for another small job. To train all the hospitality people all over the world in, they're gonna start doing little coffee shops in all the stores. So all the people, all the employees who run the coffee shops, they need to be trained as hospitality people. So they wanted me as an actor, because I'm always doing the hosting for them to train them as well.
Do you have any barista skills?
What is that? Barista skills? Huh? No, I fake myself in that.
But well, you're an actor.
Yeah.
Like, you're an actor.
So I was like, what do you have to do with the milk? Because it's funny things on the milk, on the phone.
Yes. And then, but you look so good, and you put the cappuccino on there.
Yeah. And I was like, just pretending. And I was like, no, this is the bird. This is the bird.
Yeah. They bring in the stunt steam.
Yeah. So, next one.
Who would like to be next?
Yeah, you, in front.
Can I just choose what is the name?
You want a kiss? No.
Can I choose what?
Are you?
No,
you
no,
want
no, no, this is random.
You want to bend the game, the rules.
Yeah, baby, yeah.
Go on.
Sorry.
Which one do you want it to be on next?
Oh, we'll get there.
We'll get there. It's death.
Death! Oh.
Oh! Who knows about me? Who knows about that? How many Terry Pratchett people are of Terry Pratchett's fans are here? That's only three, that's fine. Little Red America, I understand.
Who knows about the Hogfather?
Oh, of course. So, Terry Pratchett is a novel writer, a very famous one all over the world, but although, I understand, we're in America, the same story in Holland, nobody knows about it. But that was actually my second film I've done. It is a TV series, and Terry Pratchett wrote 31, I believe, Discworld novels. It's a very, it's a nice fairy tale. And Death is the very iconic character, the man with the scythe, the Grim Reaper.
And didn't you say that even though somebody else did the voice, that you did such a great job with the lines that many people on set said, how come they're not using your voice?
That is true. How do you know that?
I know these things.
Oh. You did some nice research, then. Yeah, that is true. That was actually going postal, so that was the Mr. Pump. That's not bad, but it's Mr. Pump. It is a part of the going postal story. And I was in the end of the shooting, I transformed my voice in that way that the director said to me, should we consider Marnix as the voice? But obviously, you know, I'm the character inside the costume, and they need a name. They need someone to carry the film and the character. So with that, there was Ian Richardson, a very, and later on was, what's another guy? I can't remember his name. Mr. Pump? Who did Mr. Pump? Do you know who did Mr. Pump voice? I can't remember. It's a strange man.
Perhaps they thought Death couldn't possibly come from Holland. it's a wonderful place.
Yeah, but you know, Mr. Pump is a golem, so a funny accent would be perfect. So yeah, but they didn't do it in the end. And it's fine.
Do you get along with all your actor friends?
I think so. I'm a very relaxed guy. I like to connect with people, and I think in general actors are very likable. They're very open, they're very straightforward, they're very, yeah, so we have a lot of fun. And sometimes you work harder on several films, on some movies than other movies, and then you don't get to connect as much. And on Dr. Who, for example, we had a very nice connection, and I knew Matt Smith from before, because I met him in town, and we went out
who's taller, you or Matt Smith?
I do you think? Me, of course.
Cool.
All right, I knew that the Doctor, and he could have been playing
just a little
silence. Yeah,
exactly,
a
little confusion next to you.
He's a?
Like a little fusion, like yeah. In Gulliver's Travel.
Everybody is.
All right, so somebody from the back.
Yeah. The lady in the back.
Come on.
Yay!
She's excited.
Yeah, she is. Why do you look excited?
I also met you at Fanboy.
Oh. Fanboy Expo. Yeah. Yeah. Helping? Interior design. Yeah, that's just a hobby, but it's like, I get paid for it. So, yeah. So, I recently started doing that. To tell you a little story for Harry Potter, I had to obviously go over to London, which is very near to Amsterdam. It's only 20 or 45 minutes flight. Thanks. If you are against the winter orbit. So I lived there for 4 years, and I wanted to give my acting career a go, and that's why I stayed there, and that's why I did quite a few movies. And then I decided to go back to Holland, so I don't know why, but I did. And then you get lost a little bit, and I was fed up with acting, I wanted to do something different. And I started doing interior design. And then I forgot about it, and I went back to filming stuff. And now I was in Holland for another year, and I just recently picked it up again.
I was going to ask if
Yeah, and now I'm doing, at the moment actually, I'm very busy at the moment, so I'm doing 500 square meter office in Amsterdam. Yeah, so I'm just artistic. I fake myself on every person. That's what you have to do, isn't it?
Well,
that's a really big dream.
We're going to fake this part. We're going to skip ahead to one part that everybody's interested in. Can you, and your slides up there, can you pull up a picture of the silence? Keep going. One more.
Oh, that's Mr. Buck. How do you get all these pictures, right?
They
just
wanted to
say, right? The one you yes. There we go. we'll go back to the.
Oh, right.
Trust me, every search is saying it's like the first thing that pops up.
Yeah. What? My name.
The modeling.
Oh, yeah?
Here it comes.
Is it the moon? Is it the moon? What is it?
Why don't you tell us all about that?
Oh, right.
So how did you get the role?
Yeah, that was funny because I was back in Amsterdam, like I just told you, and I got a call from my agent saying, like, Mike, I want to see you for a series that's been going on for a while in London. In England, and would you like to come over and audition for it? And at the time, all I was really trying to think was that what do you think my chances are? Because if I have to fly back and forth to London every time when I'm doing the casting, not getting it, in the end, my pockets are empty. And she said, well, now I think, come over, and if you can't pay your flight, I'll do it for you because this is a chance for you. So I didn't know anything about it at the time. I was living in London. I saw a few of the episodes on TV, and without offend you, but I saw it and I said to my friend, "Oh, this looks a little bit overacted. What is this?" And she said, "Well, don't say that to people who like it because it's been on for years and it's very big, and that's why people like it." So okay, and then. I went to the studios for the casting, and then I found out what her role was about, silence, and then I, yeah, in the end I got it. I think I was the only one they saw.
How many times have you played the silence?
How many times? Mm-hmm. Three series? Three episodes?
Three episodes?
Yeah. And then they wanted me back for, I think it was a Christmas episode, and then I wasn't available. So that one, Ross did, I think. What's his name?
We don't. Yeah. He's the other siren.
Yeah, from the one episode.
Yeah. He's a poser.
Well, listen. In the end, I mean, I'm stuck inside a costume, so I approach my roles always as if I'm a straight actor, which means. Being as myself or the character I play without any costume or anything on, like not on my face.
There was a great time in Knoxville when we were doing an interview with Neve McIntosh, who plays Madame Vastra, Dan Starkey, who's Strax, and yourself, who plays Silence. And everybody, they were talking about how hours to put on their makeup. And like, oh, I hate taking on the role, it's 8 hours on, 8 hours off. You said, I just put a hoodie on.
And then, like, maybe they were like, oh no, I have to prepare through all the preparation on the table, and they shared it with the audience. And I was sitting there and I was like, only thinking, I'll drink a little glass of wine and put on the hoodie and I go.
Yeah, you put on a men's suit.
But of course, about the joke. I mean, sometimes it's challenging to wear a costume. But to be honest, the silence was just a hoodie. So it was easy to take it off in between shots or, you know, when you're waiting for a long time, just have people to take it off.
Well, would you do us a favor? Could you show us
the silence hand, where the hand puts his high balances.
Which one? Because I have the two fingers. There's only three fingers in hand.
Yes, but whenever he's about to shoot the light.
Oh, yeah. $10.
$10.
You're such a ham. Can you do something? What do you want to do something? Woo! Good time. I like to shave it.
Yeah. That was the power.
Oh, that was the power.
Yeah, that was the energy just coursing.
Or
I get an E.
Or
you
didn't
eat, so
or you didn't eat, yeah.
Yeah.
I hope the first one.
Yeah.
So let's see. On the Wheel of Marnix. Let's see what else we have now. Let's
cruise ship. Yeah.
You spent some time on a cruise ship.
That is true.
Did you sweep the deck?
I could have, no.
We have very long.
I was just graduated the Dance Academy in Holland. I was bored. I was about 18. I was bored. I didn't know what to do. I wanted to be everything in the world, which you can't, because you have to make a choice, and I couldn't choose. And then in my local, where I live, in my area, they had a show put on, and they said, like, we need one more dancer, would you like to do it? I said, I don't know if I can dance, but let's try it. And then from that, I ended up doing the Dance Academy in Amsterdam. And when I graduated, I went to the National Ballet, which is like proper ballet, which I did a year, and then I thought, this is not really my kind of thing, dancing in like fights and stuff. And then I got the opportunity to go on a cruise ship for 8 months.
I'm sure they would hate it if you danced in tights. I would
if I were you. So I need a partner, a dance partner, then I can do it.
Oh.
We will. I will maybe later on.
Maybe later on.
He may have a dance partner later on.
Yeah.
So that's the story about the cruise ship. 8 months I've been traveling. It was a very nice cruise because I started in Lisbon, Europe, and then we went right over to Canada, and we did all the coast of Canada down to Miami Key West, and we did the Gulf of Mexico, and we did that a couple of times. You go back and forth, and then we went to South America, the top part. And from there, bringing over to Africa, and there I go. So I had a really nice trip. I've seen so much. St. Lawrence Stream is beautiful. What is it? Charleston is lovely. I remember all those little places. But at that time, it was all new to me. So traveling is one thing I really love to do.
You live quite a lovely life.
I'm 41, so.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
Oh, well, you know, all that traveling in the vortex, it makes you, you look like you're about 24 or something.
Thank you. It's all artificial.
Yeah.
It's a mask. Wait, I pick up my hoodie.
It's acting.
Yes.
So, how about on Harry Potter when you're the werewolf?
How tall are you? Over there. How tall are you? 6'7". Oh, really? Yeah, that was quite an experience. Because it was the very first big movie I did. And for that casting, I've been over several times.
Yes.
And the first casting, I got in, so I went to trial to London, then I just take a train. And I didn't know where I was going. I didn't spoke English very well. Still not, but then it was first.
But you spoke Wolf.
Yeah, I saw both. And I arrived and I saw this like sort of marquee tent, and I entered. I was a little bit late, and it was full of American basketball players.
Really?
It was full of like very tall people, and I thought, very small. And I think I was one of the smallest ones from all of them. And we had several classes, and then in the end, I was classed because of my height, but not because of that. I was that tall, but because I was skinny, I had a particular toned body, and I was flexible. So one of the parts of the
great principle,
yeah, my friend.
She loves werewolves.
I love werewolves. He wants to marry one. Yeah, but this is a picture I hardly recognize it as myself. Obviously, it's overlaid with a computer graphic image, CGI, in post production.
There's very few images on the internet, actually, of the wolf.
I know, I don't have any
items. Right on to a Harry Potter page, there's millions.
What is that?
Try going to a Harry Potter page on Facebook, there's millions!
I'll go to a Harry Potter page.
Oh, okay, yeah, Facebook. Really? But like with me or with that?
Yes, like you!
Not you, like you.
Oh, no.
Of you!
Of me, actually, of there's, you. Not people that resemble you.
There's whole entire days just dedicated to you on
Are there like really obsessive Marnik sites?
Yes, no! There's Harry Potter groups.
Because they're so that are
obsessed
awesome.
With Marnik. That,
yeah.
That do werewolf days just for Marnik.
Werewolf days?
Yeah. You know, that question from
is that like Gasparilla? So, do you have any questions about Harry Potter? Like, well, we've heard a lot from you. Perhaps some of our friends may have something. You, sir.
So, in the movie, how much of your actual like body movements were implemented into the CGI overlap? Like, how like there was CGI implemented into it, but how much of your movement was put into that?
I can't really tell. The only thing, because it was a surprise to me as well. To see it when we have the premiere in Holland, and I went to the premiere to see in Holland. I was in London as well, but I went to the premiere in Holland first, and I couldn't really tell. To be honest, I was a little bit disappointed because I had seen rushes of all the footage I've done, and it looked amazing. The only thing I couldn't do was probably stand still for longer than half an hour because the whole suit and the animatronics and the stilts, and I couldn't see, I couldn't breathe, it was so hard to do. And they had like built a whole set which wasn't just flat, it was all with hills and whatever. So I saw the rushes and they looked amazing, but then when I was disappointed, and then at that time I didn't know much about CGI and what they'd done, but the director wanted the creature to walk, to run into the bushes on all fours. And I couldn't, I just could stand and I could swipe my hand. So that little bit of scene when you see the kids and Professor Snape, what is his name in English?
Professor Snape.
Snape, yeah. You see them and you see the swipe of the hand, that for sure that's me, because then you can see hairs on the shoulder of the creature. And at that time that was one of the things where you can really be sure it was a costume because of the hairs. It was at that time it was very difficult to make hairs with CGI. I don't know how it's now, but real hair, I mean. The standing position, the walk, and that stuff, I think they just use it in CGI in the end.
Did they base, because the walk, because you obviously have a great deal of control of your body language and your movement, so you probably, in your audition, did you audition the type of walk you could do since
as a werewolf?
Yes.
Yeah, they had these special skills made for the casting and all the attendees needed to walk on the stilts, and then they could see, you know, who was talented to balance themselves. And I was the only one who could balance myself straight away, but that's because of my background as a dancer. So they had two, like a lane, they fabricated like a pole or a stick to hold on to. And the first two steps were, for me as well, were like very difficult, and then my body adjusted and I was finding my balance. And within a few steps, I could walk, and then I fell over, and then I could walk again. So I was the first one, actually the first one who could proper walk and hold my body still.
Well, we've gone over the silence, and some of your time on screen. What was that?
I don't remember.
I don't remember. Well, actually, he has the tally marks. Really, it changed his life, being the silence. So much so, what did you do so that you could always remember being the person no one remembers?
I told you one thing and you still remember it for the rest of your life. Yeah, that's true. It was, I think it was 3 years ago, here in Tampa. We had a, what was it called? The Festival of the Oh yeah, we had one in Tennessee and then one here in the Hyatt. Yeah. And I met a guy who was a tattoo artist, and he's one of the tattoo of the telemarks. So I did on my left hand. And the reason I did it for was to thank life, or to thank whatever who's orchestrating this, to thank for the for the life I'm living. I can travel. I get to meet a lot of nice people, and yeah. So, and it reminds me of myself. Yes. So I have to remind, me of myself.
I like when you showed it to me. It looked a bit like you have sutures.
Exactly. that's a good thing for the tattoo artist. But I drew it myself. So this is how I done it.
And drew it, and then he made it. Yeah.
I drew it on the spot, and then he tattooed it. But then I was like, that's not really how they do it properly in the movie. I should have watched her. So it looks like a stitch. Actually.
Yeah. Well, it looks like you had a very very excited kitty cat who gave you a scratch.
I'm allergic to cats, so that's...
No. So try to forget the kitty cat because you're allergic.
Yeah.
Let's open it up. I'm going to give this mic to Deb, and why don't you go around, and especially for people who haven't spoken, we have about maybe 6-7 more minutes. Why don't you ask them a real quick question?
It's a real quick question. When you were doing the stilt at the wolf, did they actually have the paws is what you had to stand on? And then did they give you risers or anything? Did it look like you were moving, or were you just on level ground?
No, it was proper stilts. Sure, I didn't hear it very well. It was proper stilts, and they had a made to measure for my legs, and we had to practice half a year. So I flew in on, I think it was in January, and we practiced all the way through to August, and then we start shooting in August. So we had to practice on slopes outside of the studios. Yeah.
May I ask a question? One that I've heard asked of you now 3 times at 3 different panels. Well, 2 different panels. All 3 times, a very young lady would come up and say, "Why are you the most beautiful man alive?"
Where is she?
You were all going to say that, didn't you? It happened a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, I had to throw that on there. Okay.
Here you go. Oh. Yeah, what's the craziest fat experience?
The craziest what?
Fat experience.
Fan.
Yeah.
Fan experience. Yeah. Well, that is one of them. that's a hard question. Trying to remember the craziest. Well, one one girl, she was so happy to see me that she couldn't stop crying. And she was just standing in front of my table, and I didn't know how to react. I didn't know what to do. I was like, okay, I wanted to stay with the queen, and she was like, yeah, so maybe she was so excited. Oh, Dad, she was young. Oh, come over, Dad, you can have a hug.
No, you won't do that.
Oh, we'll do it later.
Any more questions?
Three.
What's your favorite mythological creature?
Ooh, that's a good question.
Bears.
Bears. Angels. Werewolves. No, no, for sure.
I think really?
Yeah.
Something like
by noon
you get hairy.
Of course, yeah.
I'm watching, what's the series called? It's a...
Table?
No, it's not that one.
Camera?
Benton? No. Come on, bro. I watch so much. Is it the same stuff? We're watching series over and over again. And we have so many different series on Netflix. That every now and then we start a new one, so I can't remember. You'll know those. It's an English one.
Yeah.
Is
it Being Human?
No.
Being Human.
No, that's all American. It's an English one. It's an
English
one. Oh, that's an English one.
British is a British one.
It's with a lady who is possessed by the devil.
Oh, Penny Dreadful.
Yes, that's it, Penny Dreadful. I'm watching that, and I think, oh, I love that guy who plays the werewolf.
He just likes
it, doesn't he? He's getting naked all the time. Yeah,
that's actually a plot point.
Oh, that's a plot point.
Sorry,
PJ Pam,
sorry.
Favorite character you ever played?
That's a nice one. Do I have to pick one or can I have two? Okay, then it's going to be Mr. Pump from Terry Pratchett. It's the Gibbon Golem, only because to me, he was the most human fictional character, and I were real friends, and I got to know him through the whole shooting. It sounds a bit crazy because I speak to him as if he is real and he is my friend, but he became a friend. So I found something within me as an actor who connected with him, and I felt really comfortable playing that. It was really nice because I've been doing so much research to play that character about Golems and the Jewish background and what kind of character he was. And then in the end, the director said to me, "See yourself just as a very big, strong man, and you look like as if you're very evil, but you cherish a little flower. So it makes you human, makes you kind, makes you..." And that was really connecting with part of my personality, and from that, I loved playing Mr. Pump. Although I fainted one time because we were shipping in the east of Europe. It was bloody hot, 45 degrees, and I couldn't help but faint at some point. And the other character, of course, is the Silence, and it's almost the same story because the Silence is half, to me, is half human, half alien, and it was a nice sort of mixture in looking to play a character. Although there are a bunch of them, which is Mr. Bucket on the ground, is a character, and the Silence are a whole army of people. Although, you know, if you watch a particular scene, you don't know if it's that guy or if it's that guy who plays the Silence. And I wanted to portray the Silence as if it was all the same guy, although it's an army. And I think that came across very nice. Yeah.
All right, well, that's about time. That's about all the time we have. Just for everyone so they can get it right, how do you properly say your last name?
It's funny because the last name in Dutch means a trousers, pants. Like, from the trousers, it's translated. So it means it's funny, but it's
Marnix from the band.
From the pants, yeah. It's a typical Dutch name. But it's pronounced as Van den Broeke. With a running R, Van den Broeke.
You're Marnix.
Yeah. Just say Marnix, it's fine. Or Mark, as they might say to Starbucks over there. Your name, please? Mark. Because Mark is too hard.
Are you going to be going to your lunch now or straight to your autographs?
Oh no, I go to my autographs, so if you want to get some, please come by and we have a talk and I can answer your questions and I can hand out my autograph.
Yeah,
yes,
and, please. And make sure that you get one. Who here wants an autograph from Marnix?
Yeah!
Yeah. And those of you who don't want to, give anyway. He's taller than you.
Yeah, support him as well. We want to do another something here as well. So thank you very much for having me.
Of course.
Okay.
And thank you very much. Everybody, a round of applause for yourself. Yeah. Thank you. It was a real pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
It was a pleasure.